Convida-se o senhor Jacques Biot para dar início à Aula Magna de 2017.
Dear former Minister Brigadier Ferola, dear former Minister Osiris Silva, dear Vice Director Brigadier Ferrando, dear President Rectore Anderson, and all authorities in the room in your grades and qualities, and dear alumni of ITA, dear company members, dear students. Well, first of all, I have to apologize for speaking in English. I love the sound of your language, but I would be unable to make the talk in Portuguese. So I have to apologize, but I know that Brazilians are extremely international, and I'm sure that this will be perfectly understood. So I'd like to talk today about how the world is changing and what impact it has on our business of international universities of science and technology. And before starting, I would like to say how happy and honored I am to be here on the invitation of ITA. There is quite a feel of brotherhood between ITA and Polytechnique. And so I'm extremely sensitive to that. I understand ITA was very much influenced by MIT. And I was in Washington last week talking with colleagues, American colleagues, who reminded me that MIT in turn had been founded based on the concept of Polytechnique, which was founded back in 1794. So I'm kind of, like you can see from my gray hair, I'm kind of representing your grandfather. So this certainly creates a very strong link between us. On a more personal note, I would like to tell the audience that as a private pilot, modest private pilot with both a French and an Australian license, I'm extremely happy when I see nice planes flying. So I would congratulate all of those of you who have contributed to the emergence of Embraer, and you build beautiful planes. I know my friends from Airbus are in the room as well, so but truly congratulations for that. So first of all, that's what I tell my students when they come to the Ecole. You are living in a difficult world, and that's something we must really realize. It's a difficult period, and I always like to remind us that it is pretty much like the situation in which Polytechnique was created. I'm not going to talk much about Polytechnique, but just to explain you the roots of the Ecole. The Ecole was founded back in 1794 at a time where France was under heavy attack of all European armies, because, you know, we were the only revolutionary country at that time. And the members of the Committee of Public Salute, who were revolutionaries, understood that all the discoveries of the 18th century, what we call the Age of Enlightenment, would help serve and save the nation. And that's why they created the Ecole. And this is really very much still our vision. Today, obviously, the universe is not limited to one country, it's the world, and the world, as mentioned, is facing many challenges. So I'm going to elaborate a little bit on these challenges. I'll come back with more slides on that. The economy worldwide is in a very difficult situation. I mean, you see it from Brazil, I mean, you've been emerging, you've had kind of more difficult period, you're still a very strong country, but you'll see that it's difficult everywhere. Climate, I'll come back to that. Diseases, I mean, we're potentially on the verge of a very difficult times from a sanitary perspective, health perspective, and finally security. So I'll go back a bit more in detail in all those challenges. First challenge, the economy. The world globally has reached an unprecedented level of debt. 152 trillion, so that's 152,000 billion of dollars. That's higher than ever. And with the US and China holding a very large part of that, with some additional questions that are not necessarily very well understood, which are the amount of bad debt in that, what they call, I would say more polite, politically correct word, non-performing loans. And the next question also is who owes that debt? For instance, the Japanese debt is very high, but it's held by the Japanese, so it's a question among Japanese. The US debt is held mostly by Chinese, which ironically puts the US pretty much under the pressure of the Chinese government. Interest rates. Well, I've looked at your situation. I understand inflation is somewhere around 4.5 here, and inflation rates rather in the range of 12.5. So what I'm going to describe is probably surreal for you, but in the US, in Europe, in Japan, we've seen an unprecedented decline of interest rates. And now, in Europe, we have negative interest rates. That is just for physicists like you are, or whatever, a scientist. It's just like somebody tells you that light is going faster than 300,000, or that there are temperatures below the zero Kelvin. I mean, it has no sense, economically speaking, because interest rates are a measure of the preference for the present, which means that our societies in Europe are very depressive. They don't have a preference for the present. This is unexplained. And also, operationally speaking, it's a very big issue for banks. When I talk with the chairman of Société Générale, who is an alum of École Polytechnique and a good friend, he says, well, you know, if somebody brings me his money, I have to pay 0.4% to the central bank to put the money in the bank. So that's just completely the world working the other way around. So this is a very, for economists, this is something, there are no equations, no experience. And finally, if you look at things from, I would say, from the perspective of the world, what we see, and that's explaining a great deal of the strange election results that we have in the north, in the US, in Britain, we hope not in France, is the fact that globalization and disruptive technologies have brought a lot of prosperity all over the world, but this prosperity has been very unequally distributed. So there have been winners, and among which, and that's great, and that's great news, the middle class in emerging economies, and that is extremely important because that has been a great driver of the economic growth and of also welfare. But there has also been another winner, well, the 1% richest people in the north, in the US, more specifically so, and this is something that the population doesn't accept well. And what is worse, there have been losers, and the losers are mostly, on the one hand, the very, very poor, especially in Africa or Southeast Asia, and that's the, explaining the political kind of strange events that we see, it's the middle class of the North, the middle class of Europe and of the US. And these are the people who have been losing from globalization and who are now making votes which are kind of, to some extent, questioning us. That's called the elephant curve, according to Branko Milinkovic, who kind of designed this. Now, climate change, I mean, we are just back from COP21. You know, carbon dioxide, I mean, did vary over, would say, period, historical periods. But we now have also reached an unprecedented level. We see the temperature rising. We've gone through the third subsequent year of record temperature in the world. The sea level is rising. I mean, you can't see it, but the scale is millimeters, so which means that over 20 years, we gained almost 10 centimeters on sea level. So this is really something which is accelerating. And so also I didn't put the notion of extreme events, but you know that there are more and more extreme events. This is posing a challenge to the insurance industry, to everybody. Finally, in terms of diseases, we're facing an infectious decade. You've had Zika, and that's kind of showing, probably not legible, but that's the spread of the Zika epidemics throughout the world. But it's not the first epidemics that we see. We've had SARS, we've had MERS, we've had Ebola, we've had all the strange flu viruses, and cholera spinning back. And so what comes next? Well, WHO has a whole list of viruses that may attack us without even mentioning smallpox that might reappear based on terrorist acts. And also bacteria are becoming more and more resistant. So this is really a challenge. And also another challenge in terms of healthcare is the aging of populations throughout the world, with a growing proportion of people aged more than 65. And these people will obviously face a number of diseases. You know, in the West, in the North, we have really the issue of Alzheimer and Parkinson, who are exerting a very heavy toll on our societies. You have cancer, you have metabolic diseases with diabetes increasing, you have all heart and blood diseases, you have kidney diseases, etc. So aging is going to exert a very high toll on economies and also on our societies and on welfare. So this is something which obviously is a good news. We love to live longer, but this has a cost and this has consequences on our organization. And finally, I mean, you're pretty much protected, and I like your color, you know, with the very limited impact of terrorism in Brazil, but that's not the case in the US, that's not the case in Europe, and that's not the case in most of Africa and of Asia. So terrorism is really becoming an issue, and there is not just terrorism from terrorist groups, but there is also rogue states. You probably heard that this morning in Asia, which was Asian morning, was during the night for us, North Korea sent 4 missiles, of which 3 landed in the Japanese waters. I mean, we in France are great friends of the Japanese. I mean, we keep a very good relationship with our Japanese colleagues, and I can tell you that this is a serious threat that obviously nobody can ignore. So again, I think Brazil is not within reach from the North Koreans, but still that's a risk. And there are other states that could be qualified as rogue states. Finally, I mean, I just come from a conference in Washington which was devoted to cyber threats. And I can tell you that people operating, for instance, energy grids are extremely worried. There was an event 2 years ago where a Ukrainian power unit was turned down just by hackers who took control of it. We know that many things are possible. We know, for instance, that the Americans and the Israelis were able to take the control of the Iranian centrifuges. So the risk, I mean, that was for a good cause, obviously, but still, it shows that almost everything is possible now with increasing risk due to the Internet of Things. And this creates a threat to both finance, to utilities, to transportation. I mean, you're in the plane business for many of you, and you know that security of planes is obviously something that, I mean, has to be checked any time in terms of somebody taking control of a plane from a remote place. That's not completely just the hypothesis. Politics, we've seen that in the US, in all kinds of industry, and obviously for private safety. So the threat is real, and it comes, that's different from the equilibrium of terror that we had at the time of the Cold War. That can come from many sources. It obviously comes from some nation states, and our American friends are very suspicious of some big Asian countries. But rogue states also do a lot of things in that field. Plus, you have a number of groups which are completely uncontrolled, politically speaking. You have kind of large terrorist organizations who are almost states like ISIS, you also may have much smaller groups or individuals who may be either terrorists or activists or just criminals. So the threat is real. It is really kind of like a race between those who find ways to encrypt and to protect data and to protect transmissions, and those who invent new ways to get into the systems. And I talked about four challenges, but actually all those challenges are nurturing each other. And Bill Gates made it clear at a recent security conference in Munich that everybody understands that climate, for instance, is going to create a number of refugees, it's going to create poverty, which in turn favors terrorism. It also has an impact on health. Obviously, when you have political disorganization, you have less control of diseases. So it's really a big chain. The graph on the left, again, is not legible, but it's basically a graph from the Davos Forum, which shows that every challenge is in turn triggering other risks on mankind. So that's the end of the pessimistic part of my talk, and I'm glad none of you ran to get into some kind of a shelter. And now we're turning positive. We're turning positive because I think we need to be positive, and we're positive for a good reason, which is the fact that we believe in innovation and technology. So this has been theorized by a number of economists. We have one who is an alumn of ours, Jean Tirole, who is a Nobel Prize winner. I took another Nobel Prize winner because I didn't want to be kind of a domestic, and so I took Edwin Phelps, who was also a great economist, who kind of makes this point. We have Philippe Aguillon, who was formerly in Harvard, who is now back to France. They all say that innovation is the driver of prosperity, and that's our belief, because that's really the way we were founded. And I think when I hear the discussions and when I talk with my friends at ITA, I see that you also believe in technology, and I think we're right believing so. So how is technology going to help us? Well, first of all, and we'll go again through each of the challenges very quickly before we go into the impact of all this on our universities. In terms of the economy is probably one of the most difficult issues we have to tackle. Because, well, first of all, everybody in the North wants to get rid of those very low or even negative interest rates. Because as mentioned, they don't make any sense. Now the question is, they are like morphine. They are something it is very difficult to get rid of, because if you start increasing the rates, and that's probably going to happen first in the US based on a number of reasons. Janet Yellen, who is the head of the Federal Reserve, made a comment on that. The US is probably going to increase, but if you increase, this has many consequences, and this may trigger a big financial crisis. This is what happened if you look back into the economical history. Back in 1994, there was something that the economists called the Great Bond Massacre, where three minor events, one of which was the increase in rates, triggered a complete crisis in bond value and a big, big kind of big disorder in the market. So this time, policymakers have to increase rates in a very prudent way, and this is the reason why it takes so long. And so we'll see how they succeed in getting us rid of the drug, which is the low interest rates. But also we see that if they increase interest rates, all our Western countries, which live on high debt, which is the case of the US, which is the case of most countries in Europe except Germany, if you increase rates, this will accelerate the deficit of the balance, because this time, for instance, France pays almost no interest rates, although we have 100% GDP, the equivalent of 100% GDP in debt. Now, if we start paying 1 or 2% or 3% on 100% of our GDP, this means that we lose 1 or 2 or 3% GDP that goes into the deficit. And so you see this may accelerate very fast, and this is a big, big issue, because at the same time we want to reduce the debt, we want to reduce the deficit, and if we increase the interest rate, the equation is a bit tricky, and so this is an interesting question. Also, we want to ensure more harmonious growth. The emerging have been doing a great job over the last 20 to 30 years. Now we have one continent which is eastwards for you, which is on our south, which is Africa, where there will be 800 million of young people coming in the next few years or decades. And if we don't find employment for them, it will be a very difficult time for the world. So we really need to bring more countries into emergence. So that's the problem that we face. We do collaborate a lot with Africa because we believe in Africa, but it will be a very tough issue to raise African elites and to bring Africa to the level of emergence so that there isn't too much disorder all over the world. Now, what are the means? And that's where the world needs you and needs my students and needs students from other universities. All this will be done only if you use fairly sophisticated mathematics, you know, more and more mathematics in to do modeling, to do data science, to exploit databases. Economics is obviously progressing a lot. You will need public policy, and this is certainly something that we need to teach our students, because all this can only be done with clever regulation. Regulation is needed, it shouldn't kill the industry, so this is something very difficult. And also, looking into history and doing some sociology will be needed. So that's the first path to solve the economic challenge. Now, if we look at the climatic challenge, the objectives are very clear. They've been set by the Conference of the Parties in Paris last year, and almost all countries signed very quickly, and if they would embark on this objective of reducing the temperature increase by less than 2%, because if it goes higher, we don't know what will happen. Now, what does this mean again for us engineers? Well, first of all, it needs more monitoring of climate change, because we know that what we call climato-skeptics will continue to say nothing should be done and there should be more use of coal, etc. So we need to convince the world that the issue is serious, and that's where we use what? We use satellites, we use stratospheric balloons, we use planes, we use drones. So that's a business for you guys to follow up really what's going on in the atmosphere and in the seas and everywhere in the world. Now, what do we need also? We need computer science. If you want to modelize the weather, especially if you go into extreme events, you see more and more that you try to reduce the grid at which you look at events, and the more you try to predict the weather in a precise place, the more data you need, because the more complex the equation becomes. So more computer science, more material science to get into the engineering of photovoltaic cells, which will be cost efficient. You know, I mean, photovoltaic has definitely reached a level where it now starts to become economic, but there is still progress to do in terms of yield and in terms of cost. So that's a beautiful field of progress. And same for vehicles, planes, cars, etc. I forgot to mention a very important issue, because it has to do with the cyber risk that we'll mention. All the paradigm in the energy industry is going to change. The past was that you would have kind of a base consumption, and if somebody would need more power, utilities would start a new generator and would start a gas generator and increase power. Now, the more we go towards renewable, and renewables are now achieving 30%, I would say, rate, market range, the more you have renewables, less control you have of production. So the paradigm is shifting from an industry which is driven by consumption and where the producer follow the consumer to an economy where the consumer will have to follow the producer, because the producer will be dependent on wind, on sun, on a number of things. And so all what we see in the energy industry is the fact that we need to work on more algorithms to tell consumers when they could stop their consumption to comply with the production of wind and of sun, etc. So this is going to change. This will need a lot of infrastructure and IoT to monitor exactly the consumption and the production in any place. So this becomes very complex. And so this is something where we'll need computer science and maths, but this is also something which will make the energy industry even far more vulnerable to cyber threats. Finally, we need economists, because there is a big issue of carbon price, and this is certainly something which needs some input from economists, and obviously mathematics. You will see mathematics everywhere. New diseases. All objectives again are very clear, and they are set by WHO. The means, well, of course there are some, I would say, sciences that are not so well taught, probably in our institutions. I don't know how it is at ITA, but at the Polytechnique we started biology just when I was a student there, which is something like 40 years ago, and we didn't go very far, so there is still progress. And certainly we'll need more biology to solve virus diseases, find new vaccines, etc. But again, engineering sciences will be very important, because we'll need more data and data analytics. For instance, we have big projects to try to tap into the health insurance data to understand if some drugs are dangerous or things like that. We will see plenty of development of what we call precision medicine. Today, drugs, you know, have a very bad yield. I mean, for us engineers, if you look at a typical clinical trial for a drug, usually you would end up with a result that pharmaceutical company that I know well, that I've been serving, but basically they say, oh, we have a very efficient drug. What does that mean? It means that in one group, there were 40% non-responders, and in the other group, 60% non-responders. So they tell us the drug works well, and that's true. It's bringing benefit. But actually, it's bringing benefit only to one in six people, because the others either don't need it, because they would be treated by placebo, or they are not treated at all, neither by the placebo nor by the drug. So there is a lot of room to improve and make sure that people receive absolutely the drug that works. So this is something which starts, especially in cancer, with genomics. And genomics, again, is something which borrows a little bit from biology, but very much from engineering sciences. And if you look at how engineers have been able to reduce the cost of decoding the human gene, you know, the first attempt to decode the human gene something like 15 years ago cost $3 billion. Now you can have your genome decoded for $1,000. So it's incredible. It's much, much more efficient than the Moore's law. I mean, they've done incredible progress, and this will also serve in the infectious field to identify new bugs, because if somebody comes and has some kind of undiagnosed illness, if you take his fluid, you will be able, with this type of equipment, to identify your new germs much more faster than in the past. So a lot of progress again, and I'm also not forgetting everything that engineers can bring in the field of prosthesis. For instance, we have projects on exoskeletons, where you can take somebody who doesn't walk, and put an exoskeleton, and they become again able to move. So beautiful tracks for you guys to embark on. Finally, security. Well, security is a pretty difficult objective. I'd like to emphasize the fact that, first of all, it's not just a question of fighting against terrorists. You also want to suppress the base on which of which they are fed, which is poverty. So certainly economic policy and public policy is very important, and bringing welfare to the population is certainly the first way to decrease the risk of terrorism. But then you still have plenty of terrorists, so you need to fight against them and to fight against cyber threats. And this is where, again, mathematics are very important, so cryptology is doing huge progress, so encryption techniques, data analytics. I, just before coming to Washington, I visited the Thales Innovation Days, where they have now systems which, just looking at the net, are able to identify somebody who doesn't behave in a normal way, and this is just from internet, from artificial intelligence. And with this, they are able to target people who should be put under surveillance. So, really big, I mean, big potential for you who are doing mathematics, computer science. Obviously, economy and finance will be involved with that. And I always insist on the need for philosophy, because we're in a world which becomes increasingly intolerant, and that's what terrorists try to take for us. They try to push us against each other, and I think it is very important, and that's something I insist at Polytechnique. We have 65 nationalities, and I always insist on them to work together and keep at peace together. So at the time of the war between Russia and Ukraine, we had Ukrainians and Russians working together. We have Jews and Muslims working together. Now, I think really, as universities, we must teach tolerance, because this is the key to really obtaining less terror in the world. So, in summary, you've seen that on all the slides, for all challenges, you need maths, you need computer science, you need material science to do smart materials and clever materials, you need economics, and I could add a few more sensors. And you see more and more digital coming into the picture, because you have systems which are smarter and smarter, and you need data somewhere to trigger an impact somewhere else. So that's pretty much the Internet of Things. So I've just quoted Jeff Immelt and John Chambers to say that the Internet of Things will play a very big role. It's also fragility, and that brings me to the second part of my talk, which is how we universities should we change to address these issues and bring solutions to industry, who are our clients, and to you students, who are also to some extent our clients and who come to us to learn knowledge that will help you solve those issues. So basically, the first question is, how does a university create value? And a university creates value, first of all, because it taps from existing knowledge, and using the brains of the scientists and of the faculty there, it creates new knowledge. And that's our first task, which is to really bring value from existing knowledge to create new knowledge. Now, of course, some of that knowledge goes back into the global reservoir of knowledge, and which is richer after that. But also, we use all that knowledge to educate students and to make them more knowledgeable. So that's obviously the task which is best known from outside. So probably people, politicians from outside, would see us foremost for our education role. But we also have other roles. We have a role vis-à-vis industry, because those students that we teach will find jobs, and we transfer knowledge to industry. And also, more and more, what we see is that students don't necessarily go to big industry, but they are entrepreneurs by themselves, and so they will create jobs. And finally, because of open innovation, the big industry will tap from all the new innovations that are developed in startups. So that's basically, from my perspective, the value chain of a university. Now, what's the impact of digital on that? I see a dual impact, and sometimes people just think in terms of books. But first of all, I think we have a role which is to teach the digital revolution, because as mentioned, the world is facing challenges. Technology, and foremost digital, will help solve those challenges. So we need to teach digital. But then we are like every other industry. We're like the hotel industry, like airlines, like almost all industries. I talk with the general, with the CEO of Saint-Gobain. He tells me, well, digital is hitting my business. You know, it's brick and mortar. Saint-Gobain is just kind of construction material. But still, he says, digital is changing my business. So digital is changing all businesses, and it is changing our business that we do at universities to do research, education, and entrepreneurship. So digital is an object for us, but we are a subject of digitalization. And I think it's important for us to get that and to get prepared for that, because our industry partners, who are very important for our students, for our scientists, they expect this from us, and I'm kind of, I see that at ITA, you have that culture of interfering with industry, which is very important. Our industry partners, they will hire students from us, so they want our students to be immediately employable in a digital world, and they want also to train their, to retrain their existing employees, because digital is changing their business model. Also, when they hire students from us, they will want to be sure that we're still up to date in terms of our teaching methods, and that the students we put on the job market have been trained with appropriate technology. So they really want to know what we do from this perspective. So if we look at digital as an object, well, teaching digital is actually, it's not just teaching transmission and electrical engineering and mechanical engineering. It's much more complex than that. Because if you look at what you need to digitalize the society, well, obviously, you need science and technology with both disruptive and more incremental innovation. You need infrastructures, I'll come back to that. You need to change the business models and the corporate strategy. You need to think in terms of the impact of employment. We were talking about the Africans who will need a job, but what about the Europeans and Americans and potentially Brazilians who might lose their jobs if robots do their job in their place? So you've got to look at how to maintain employment. You need to work on societal acceptance, because we see more and more parts of society resisting digitalization, and you need, obviously, regulations, because, I mean, if you let the market do everything, it would be very efficient, but it may be somewhat unfair in some cases, or even inefficient for a certain time. So this means that digital cannot be owned by just one faculty. It has really to be a project of all faculties who have to work together to really bring a package that makes it possible for students to learn all the necessary skills to be prepared for that world. So if you look at science and technology, what should we learn? Well, we should, first of all, have a research that is what I call situated in Pasteur's quadrant. That's a classification of research which dates back to Stokes back in 1990. Think about applications should be just trying to improve knowledge at the frontier of knowledge. And that's what Stokes called the Bohr quadrant. There are people research at the frontier of knowledge, but you think about the applications, he called it Pasteur's quadrant, because Pasteur was both a very good fundamental scientist, but also, whenever he jumped on something, he thought, oh, well, that might be useful in real life. And so this is really what we try to obtain from our scientists. The contract that I have with our scientists is, you're much better than I am in your field, so you know what the frontier of knowledge is, and feel free to do what you think is really warranted. But I ask you to tell me what it could be useful for society. And so this is our deal. You know what you do, but you tell me what it could be at some stage useful for in real life. And this is very important, I think. Also, research and technology have to be very much disciplinary, and I think we need in university to think about kind of bringing faculties to work together, because there is nothing that can be solved just by one faculty. And you have to mix math and computer science. It was very difficult in the beginning, for instance, for data analytics to have the people from the math department and the people from computer science department to work together. And then when I talk with my colleagues and friends in university throughout the world, they all tell me it's very difficult to have these people work together. Well, but you need to do that, because that's the way you create value in data analytics. And so that's something we've been able to do. We're extremely happy with that. Corporate strategy, I mentioned the impact on employment. So definitely we need to teach students on all the Schumpeterian economics so that they believe in innovation. Also work on job contract law and economics, and kind of accompany all the big changes that this is going to have on the economy. And also there is a need for executive education. And finally, for social acceptance, well, we need to teach them law, IP law, competition law, and to teach them HR management. So obviously we're not the only ones who have to bring digital into society. It's a shared responsibility, but as you can see, we have a very important responsibility in this, along with governments, along with industry, along with citizens, along with bankers, but this is a very important role. Now, if we look into the impact of digital on us, there were people a few years ago who thought that we would disappear, and so there would be no more Aula Magna. Maybe the students would be happy with that, but basically they thought that all education would come from the net, and so that was a very bold quote from this Sebastian Flun, who created a MOOC company back 15 years ago. Now, we think it's not the case, because it misunderstands the value creation chain that I described. Basically, you can uberize teaching, but to some extent, but what you cannot uberize is the fact that we bring students not just knowledge, but we bring them know-how, soft skills, kind of management skills. We bring them job experience from internships, and I think internships are very important for you, just like for us. Many, I think 40% of our students find their job from their internship, so it's really something very important. And networking, and that's why I'm so happy to see the link that you're able to keep at ITA with your alumni, because that's also part of the value that you bring to your students. The young ones, you know that you can call upon the older ones, and this is something that the net will not replace. So this is very important. And so basically all these things, and in the interest of time I'll skip that slide, all these things cannot be replaced by the net. Also the teamwork projects that we establish. And so in summary, why should we pay a lot of attention to digital, but not fear too much digital? I think it's a way to outreach to a larger number of students, and I'll give you a few numbers from our experience. It's a way to spread education into remote places of the country or into remote countries where they have no access to education. So this is certainly an important role. A way also to spread education to lower income students. So great, great interest. It's also something which challenges our faculty to really think again about how to change our teaching, go to flipped classes, and change the way in which we do the teaching. So, and it's also a good, something important for our reputation to be able to show that we embarked on MOOCs, digital courses. The challenges are, it's not just filming the faculty, you really need a production team that will redo the courses in a completely different way. You need to find a business model. In our case, we're funded by one of our alumni who gives us money to do that, but it's not a profitable activity, so that's something we need to think about. Some American firms have been able to make it profitable, so we're watching how this turns out. And obviously, there will be a need to talk with HR people in companies, because how will they value somebody who comes with a digital degree obtained from whatever university? So there are some questions ahead still. Plus, not every student has internet access all over the world. So that's, again, an issue of infrastructures. Our experience is that, we've started MOOCs, massive and online courses. We don't have many students who have followed it because we went into elite courses. We have some where we've had 4,000 people who have been enlisted, and they are the only 4,000 people in the world who are interested in the subject. So we have a 100% outreach, but not many students to boast about in the end. So we're now in the range of 150 people who have been listed on that. And then we keep on producing about 6 to 10 new courses every year. But once again, students outside seem to be happy. They say this improved their perception of LICs, but we still need to work on the business model, and I've challenged my people on what you want to do exactly with this. So in summary, what's our contract with students? I think our contract, and that's something that rankings doesn't reflect well. Our first contract is employability. They come to us because they want a job. That's what I tell families when I greet families, when we incorporate students. Tell them, my contract with you is that your kids will have a good job that they will love and that will pay them correctly. So employability, it's based on selection, and that's something which we have in common. You're highly, highly selective. We are highly selective, and we select students not just for the sake of taking the cream and really kind of being able to then put them on the market, on the job market, but if you select them, you can then adapt the course to the students and the students to the course. So it's the way selection, it's not, you know, it's often a bad word in France because the French don't want selection. But selection is really the way to have a class which is adapted to the teacher and to have people who are able to follow the course. So selection is very important. The content of the courses is obviously something very important, and the way in which we distribute this is becoming more and more important. So to ensure employability, what we need is industry feedback, hence the relationship with the alumni. We need to teach them soft skills, internships, do executive education. Selection, what we see, I don't know whether it's the same here, I'd be interested to kind of talk offline, is that this, what we call, what sociologists call the Z generation, is far more generous than our generation was. And that's what makes me so happy with my students, and I guess what makes Rachel Anderson happy with the students here. They really, I'm talking to the young ones, you're smart and generous, and this is something which is great in our world, which we appreciate, and very strong in math, very open also. So this is a great period to be in the world of universities. The content has to be personalized. Just I mentioned personalized medicine, and I say I switched from a field where I was promoting personalized medicine to a field where we need to promote personalized education, really adapt our courses to every individual. They have to be current, obviously, and to be pluridisciplinary. And for the medium, we discussed at length the impact of digitalization. Industry is clearly an essential stakeholder, so I put here the list of companies with which we have an agreement, but I know that at ITA you have the same type of relationship with the industry. And so what I'd like to tell industry representatives in the room is that for us, you don't bring just money. Obviously, the line philanthropy is here, But what I find in my relationship with industry is also strategic inspiration, because your businesses are kind of really challenged by digitalization. And I think we need to listen to the challenges you face to see how we can solve the challenges we face. And so, because our business is hit by digitalization just like yours. So strategic inspiration is very important. Research and technology collaboration. We need teachers from faculty from the industry to bring real world experience to our students. Obviously, they can fund our startups or acquire them. And let's be cautious, because what we see, especially in the United States, is that some companies are now starting their own universities. There is a Google University, there is a, I think, a Facebook University or whatever. And so let's be very careful. They will take our job and start to do their own teaching. So, so they are inspirers, but also potential competitors. I'd just like to say that I'm thankful to my alumni, just like Rector Anderson is thankful to you alumni. I mean, the école couldn't survive without a very strong alumni support from both our foundation, which is the one raising the money, and from the association, which is the one keeping the group together. And I think that's also something very strong. And this the only slide which was really Polytechnique inspired, the rest could probably apply to every other university in the world. I'd like just to summarize the keywords that we think should apply to our activity: excellence, integrity, which is very important in our world, multidisciplinarity, audacity, and attention to the world. And with this, I'd like to thank you and remind you of this word, which is very important, from President Truffaut, when she was elected as Harvard University president. That's a wonderful phrase, I think, that we should all keep in mind. We're all teachers, but we also are all learners, and this is why I'm so happy to be here to learn from you as well. So thank you.
Convidamos o professor Dr. Anderson Ribeiro Correia a fazer a entrega de uma homenagem ao Sr. Jacques Biot e proceder o encerramento da aula magna do ano letivo de 2017 do Instituto Tecnológico de Aeronáutica.
Thank you for your lecture, Mr. Jacques Biot. Very brilliant, very inspiring, very visionary. It confirms the goals that we have at ITA and other organizations here. We are very excited to watch it, and I'm very proud to have you here today. Mas só para finalizar, acho que foi interessante a palestra que mostra vários desafios que o mundo enfrenta e como o ITA tem trabalhar através de suas pesquisas, seus ex-alunos. Eu comecei a lembrar vários ex-alunos que nós tivemos e como eles trabalharam, estão trabalhando nessa linha. Lembrei do Guararique, lá na Casa dos Ventos, buscando a questão climática. Carlos Nobre, grande pesquisador da área climática. Lembrei do Coito, da Texis, que montou uma empresa focada nessa área de energia. Foram os economistas, lembrei do Carlos Pacheco, brilhante engenheiro, mas na área de economia. Lembrei aqui também do Brigadeiro Mattielli, do professor Chiepa, que estão trabalhando no laboratório de bioengenharia do ITA, trazendo várias frentes novas aqui na área de pesquisa. Professor Cunha, professor Ney Soma, na área de security, trabalhando com os alunos e com empresas também. Lembrei do Parque Tecnológico, Internet of Things, tem um acordo grande lá com a Ericsson, um trabalho brilhante. Lembrando também do Ricardo Galvão, que está aqui presente, diretor do INPE, né? Físico brilhante, engenheiro brilhante, e o INPE, né, que tem um papel importantíssimo em todas as questões que foram mencionadas. Gostei muito da questão da revolução digital. A gente está começando agora uma iniciativa com a Coursera, né? Eles mostraram que tem uma iniciativa com 145 mil alunos já inscritos. O ITA, ano passado, começou a iniciativa, o professor Clóvis, o professor Jackson também, e no ano passado já tiveram 70 mil inscritos em ambos os cursos, de 50 países. E já tentando trazer também para dentro do ITA já a digitalização. Lembrei também do quadrante Pasteur, essa câmera, toda vez que apresenta mostra o quadrante, né? E hoje ele fica me cutucando, né? Tá vendo?
Olha o quadrante ali.
Eu peguei a defesa, já está até decorando já, né? Falou sobre a seleção dos alunos, strong in maths. Muita gente reclama do ITA, porque o ITA tem tanta matemática, tanta física. É porque o ITA é bom por causa disso. E a Polytechnique recebe os alunos lá na França, porque eles são bons em matemática, física, no fundamental. O fundamental é um dos nossos principais DNAs que nós temos. A conexão com a indústria é tão gratificante, ter toda a indústria aqui presente, de defesa, os institutos do CTA, o Brigadeiro Terra, representando o IAE, a indústria presente, isso é a grande diferença. Né? Tive num fórum de reitores há uma semana, os 10 reitores das principais universidades brasileiras, e toda a reclamação. Falta foco nas universidades, foco com a indústria. E o ITA, felizmente, foi criado com esse DNA. Eu fiquei muito feliz de ter mencionado, o professor já criou, que o ITA foi criado pelo MIT e o MIT foi criado pela École Polytechnique, né? Eu fico mais orgulhoso porque o Pacheco dizia que a Unicamp também foi criada pelo ITA, né? Então eu acabo também na, um pouquinho do DNA da École Polytechnique. E depois que eu assumi a reitoria, muita gente me pergunta: mas cadê o acordo com o MIT que vocês prometeram que ia fazer? Não saiu o acordo com o MIT? Quando eu falo, a gente tem acordo com quem criou o MIT. Então, está reduzindo essa dependência do passado. Mas, queria agradecer novamente. I'd like to thank you. Ele tem uma tradutora russa, mora na França, mas fala português também. Ela está fazendo português. A Cristina é muito gentil. I thank you for your, again, for your participation. And I'm very sure that everyone here has delighted very much your presentation. Thank you. Para encerrar, no cargo de reitor e na função de presidente da congregação do ITA, declaro encerrada a cerimônia de início do ano letivo de 2017 do Instituto Tecnológico de Aeronáutica.
Senhores, solicito-se aos presentes que aguardem a saída das autoridades. Está encerrada essa cerimônia. Bom dia a todos. Atenção, auditório.
Obrigado pela presença. À vontade.